Hey, y'all. Thank you for being here. Good evening. My name is Victoria Fox, and I am president of Young Americans for Freedom here at the University of Mississippi. YAF is a conservative student organization that promotes ideas of individual liberties, strong national defense, free enterprise, and traditional conservative values. So in doing so, we bring conservative speakers to campus. We have activism initiatives. And if you're interested in this, if you're interested in those speakers, interested in those initiatives, we want you in our organization. So please reach out to any of our members, follow us on Instagram. We'd love to get you involved. I am so grateful to the Young Americans Foundation and the Logan family for everything they did to put this event together and their generous contributions. I'd also like to thank our incredible advisors, the student union staff, and the many volunteers for their hours of work, without which none of this would be possible. So tonight, we are so excited to welcome a strong advocate of conservative values and principles. His influence inspires us to fight for conservatism on our college campuses. Tonight's speaker is the celebrated host of the Michael Knowles Show at the Daily Wire and the book club at PragerU. He's also the author of the best-selling book, Speechless. Without further ado, the University of Mississippi welcomes Michael Knowles.
All right. All right, this is fabulous. Ole Miss. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you to YAF, as always, for hosting. Thank you to the Logan family for supporting this lecture series. This is the last stop on this semester's lecture tour, and it is a great, great pleasure to end the semester here at Ole Miss, to end the semester with the normal, friendly, happy people of Ole Miss, especially after my last visit. Oh, it's so good. The smiling faces. A couple of weeks ago at my last campus appearance, I was at the University of Pittsburgh, where the leftist welcoming committee blocked the doors, threw an explosive at the venue, and burned me in effigy. This is much more friendly. At Ole Miss, I think that we just burn cigars after the speech. That's what I'm told. Maybe over a whiskey, but not over a Bud Light. No. Someone here told me that Bud Light is what they drink down in Starkville. I don't know. That's just what I was told. I don't know. What did I do to arouse the ire of the Pittsburgh leftists? Well, I said that men and women are different, and that men can't become women, and women can't become men, and we probably ought to stop pretending that they can, especially since this pretense entails taking away the rights and customs of a great many people. I was burned in effigy for saying that women ought to have their own bathrooms. I know that sort of thing does not happen at Ole Miss. Ole Miss has not fallen into the transgender madness. If it had, it would be called Ole Mister, and that would be... Good night, everybody. Can I see you? No, I did not come here tonight to talk about transgenderism, not because it's not an important issue, but because I am sick of talking about it. It's all anybody ever talks about anymore. Did you ever think 10 years ago that this is what we would be talking about in the year of our Lord, 2023? What an indictment of our nation that we have decayed so much that we now have to expend all this time and all this energy attempting to discern the difference between boys and girls. No wonder people can't afford eggs. No wonder we have a collapsing economy, insecure energy, 70s-style stagflation on the horizon, and the looming prospect of World War III. Now, I am not here to talk about transgenderism. I am here to talk about the effigy. It is a very strange thing to be burned in effigy. I don't know if any of you have ever been burned in effigy. That Pittsburgh was my first time. Why did they do it? It was not, presumably, to harm me. That's what they had the explosives for, though thankfully they were not very good at using them. No, it wasn't to harm me, and the effigy that was burned was not actually me. Didn't even look like me. It was made of a generic shirt and chinos stuffed with a pillow or something. It was topped with a picture of my face on which the leftists drew a little Hitler mustache, which I consider to be Italian erasure. If you were going to compare me with any 20th century dictator, I would think it would be only ethnically appropriate to choose Benito Mussolini rather than Hitler, but what am I to say? I found the effigy downright lazy. Even so, it symbolized me. And I, to them, symbolized opposition to the transgender ideology, and so they burned a symbol of a symbol of a thing that they hate. The Libs, for all of their faults, are very good at understanding and wielding symbols. They've focused most of their political efforts in recent years on appropriating, perverting, and wielding symbols. That is why they're so insistent that we all use the wrong pronouns to refer to men who are confused about their sex. That's why they insist that we call illegal aliens undocumented Americans, dreamers. That's why they insist we call criminals justice-involved persons. That's my favorite one. They're the opposite of that, but we have to call them, they're injustice-involved persons, actually. That's why we have to call babies products of pregnancy and clumps of cells. The whole project of wokeness, which we used to call political correctness, is just a campaign to appropriate and pervert the symbols that we all use and encounter at every moment of the day, from the moment we wake up until the moment that we put our heads on our pillows at night, even while we dream. The left is hell-bent on controlling and perverting signs and symbols because those are the means through which we interact with reality. They not only influence, but actually constitute the way that we view and think about the world. I'll give you an example. I can't conceive of evil in the abstract. Neither can you. We think about evil through particular events, perhaps, a mass shooting, let's say, and more generally, we think about it through symbols, persons and symbols. When I see an image of a pentagram, or fire and chains, or a devil horn tattoo, I know that I am likely encountering a member of the Biden administration. Which, no, that's not true. That's not nice. That's not true. They fired one of those guys. Biden fired the one who had the leather on and with the whips and the chains who stole ladies' suitcases. He's gone and he's being prosecuted. But one of them is still there. The guy with the pentagram tattoo and the leather harness in the shape of a pentagram on top of the pentagram tattoo, the monkeypox are. He is still working for Biden, which is kind of weird, I would say. But diabolical signs and symbols are prevalent even outside of the White House. They have been since time immemorial. When we see those signs, we begin to get a picture of what evil means. Because signs and symbols represent something, which means that if one can control and manipulate and pervert symbols, one can pervert the way that society understands fundamental concepts. This is why the libs obsess over making us all use the wrong pronouns. If Bruce Jenner is a man, then he obviously has no right to use the women's bathroom. If, however, Caitlyn Jenner is a woman, then she has every right in the world to use the women's bathroom. After all, she's a she. She even has a woman's name. Now, when we actually encounter men who pretend to be women in the flesh, we know that they don't belong in women's bathrooms. But we rarely actually encounter such people. For most people, most of the time, the way we interact with transgenderism is through symbols, names, pronouns, highly curated images on TV and on TikTok. Dylan Mulvaney doesn't really look like a woman. If you've ever seen a photo of him without makeup, you know. Even after the feminizing surgeries, he still looks like a man. But sometimes, with enough makeup, in just the right lighting, curated by just the right cinematographers and photographers, he looks somewhat more passably like a woman. And that's enough for a political movement to succeed. The public does not interact with Dylan Mulvaney. Few people have met him. But everyone, just about everyone, now regularly interacts with representations of Dylan Mulvaney, representations that have been crafted by artists to look as feminine as possible. At the level of more abstract symbols, transgenderism is represented by a flag made up of baby blue and light pink stripes, colors that we associate with newborn babies, that we associate with innocence. This is a profoundly significant symbol in that the activists portray the transgender transition as a sort of a rebirth, a suicide for the old self, now referred to literally as a dead name, and a new birth of a new person with new pronouns and a whole new biography. None of those symbols convey the darker side of transgenderism, the sterility, the butchered forearms, the grotesquely carved genitals, the bone disorders, the depression, the women losing their rights and spaces in public life, all the rest of it. The old representations did convey the disorder of that ideology. Silence of the Lambs comes to mind. The new symbols are so bright and normal and happy. And since, until recently, most people encountered transgenderism only through symbols, bright, normal, and happy is how many people had come to see it. It is very telling that the backlash against transgenderism came only when its practical effects began to interfere with people's daily lives, when it turned up in elementary schools, the gender unicorn cropping up in third grade, when it deprived girls of their trophies and scholarships, when it infected the minds of people's children. That's how powerful the symbols are. Only when the practical effects of an ideology are at our doorstep does the underlying reality begin to break down the persuasive power of symbols. The left's skill and insight into symbols is ironic because leftism is largely predicated on a rejection of meaning, of the relation between the symbol and the symbolized. Our civilization has traditionally understood the body to be a symbol of the soul. Transgenderism rejects any such link. Transgenderism says that our bodies have nothing to do with who we really are. Same goes for our names. Our names are symbols that represent us, our identities. That's why Johnny Cash wrote a comedic song called A Boy Named Sue. Not so comedic anymore. Transgenderists reject that link too. For the transgenderists, Sue is not a girl's name, and it's not a boy's name. And there are no girls' names, and names don't mean anything, and bodies don't mean anything, and nothing means anything at all other than what we want it to mean. But what's strange is that they don't really believe that. And the way that we know that they don't really believe that they don't really believe that nothing matters, is that nothing matters more to trans activists than their names and their pronouns, and all the symbols that refer to them. If someone were to call me the wrong name, let's say someone walked up to me, forgot his glasses, and he referred to me as Rachel Maddow, I would not be offended if he called me she and her as a result of that. I would find that kind of funny. Transgender-identifying people, who theoretically reject the importance of symbols, they care more about their names and pronouns than anyone else, because no one ultimately can deny meaning. Leftists have long railed against formality, hierarchy, ritual. They hate uniforms, titles, ornamentation, structure, orthodoxy, liturgy, norms of speech and behavior. The leftists are sui generis, they say, and they don't want anyone suppressing their unique, totally distinctive, not at all derivative style and self-expression. And yet, they all look and sound so similar. They all partake of the same symbols. The other day, a girl popped up on my Instagram feed. She had mentioned me on Instagram. She was not happy with me. And so I pull up the video. Young gal, articulate, good-looking, looked generally normal. But I noticed that she had a piercing right in the middle of her nose. And you can call it prejudice, and you can call it intuition. You could call it, perhaps, interpretive skill. But I knew instantly that this gal was into weird, new agey crystal stuff. I just knew it. That single symbol. She hadn't mentioned anything about that, but that symbol, that single piercing, in the context of her overall demeanor, led me to draw that conclusion. So what did I do? I had to click on the Insta handle to see if I would. And what happens? One of the very first things I see, it's a crystal. It's like five crystals. If there's a weird idol statue, there's some fairy kind of new agey jargon, there's a lot of witchy stuff. Perfect prediction. No one no matter how distinctive, no matter how nonconformist, can escape the intelligibility of signs and symbols. The Libs have other telltale signs, you all know them, the colorful hair, the absurdist tattoos, the frowns, above all the frowns. They have their own liturgical chants, Black Lives Matter, Trans Lives Matter, on and on and on. This is such a lovely reprieve from that because I'm at Old Miss now, but all of the schools that I've been to this semester, that's how it opens up, this chant until security hauls these zombies out of the room. They have their own sacred rites, abortion, the transgender transition, and they have their own rituals. For one, they burn us in effigy. Even the leftists who believe that they can impose whatever meaning they want on an otherwise meaningless world, even they submit to prescribed, predictable, intelligible symbols. You would think that if anyone, conservatives would get this. Conservatives believe in God, at the very least in a transcendent moral order. We believe in virtue, sin, temptation. We believe in nature. We think things have a purpose. We believe in the soul. We believe in metaphysical reality. We believe there is a deeper meaning to reality, and we believe that there is a connection between this deeper meaning and the sensible world. And yet somehow, conservatives have ignored all of this for decades. Worse than ignore it, we've ceded so many important symbols to the left. For 3,400 years, the rainbow symbolized God's covenant with man that he would never again destroy the world in a flood. It's a beautiful symbol. It's a beautiful symbol. And then the Libs took it and turned it into a symbol of weird sex stuff. 3,400 years. And then overnight, they take the symbol. Now the Libs have one of the most beautiful symbols ever to appear, a symbol given to us by God, and they use it to promote weird sex. There are many other examples, some of them much more subtle. Since the founding of the GOP, what is the color most typically associated with it? Most people think that Republicans' color is red. It's not. The answer is blue. From the beginning of the party until very recently, Republicans were the party associated with blue. How about the Democrats? For most of history, what has been the color associated with the Libs? Most people today think it's blue. It's actually red. This is why we call leftists reds, pinkos, the Red Army. In American politics, the colors were not set in stone, but blue was overwhelmingly the Republican color. And then, in the year 2000, everything changed. Liberals, led by Tim Russert of NBC, began referring to red states and blue states, and he flipped the colors. Now, I am not saying that this is some kind of grand conspiracy. I won't put on my Alex Jones voice, start telling you all about the frogs, but I can't help but notice. I'm not suggesting that Russert and the other Libs were even conscious of the symbolic effect of that decision, but the change was very odd. Blue is most people's favorite color. About 30% of people say that blue is their favorite. Just 12% of people say that red is their favorite color. Number one is blue. Red is way down the list at number four. I'm not saying that presidential campaigns rise and fall on the colors blue and red. But perception, attraction, favorability all matter a lot in politics, and much of it is subconscious. So whether by design or just by gut instinct, Democrats seized a significant semiotic advantage, and conservatives let them do it. Conservatives tend to be more practically minded. We've wanted to talk about job creation and tax cuts and regulation. Okay, all good things. But none of those policy tweaks will ever matter at all if we let the liberals redefine the country. While conservatives were busy writing white papers on Social Security reform, the Libs have been rewriting our nation's history. Nicole Hannah-Jones explained this on Morning Joe a couple of months ago. I know not one single person in this room watches Morning Joe, so I will read to you what she said. She said, "The arc of the universe doesn't bend one way or the other. We bend it." Jones is the left-wing fabulist behind the New York Times' 1619 project, which argued, implausibly, that the American Revolution was fought to preserve slavery. Completely absurd idea. This is an idea rejected even by leftist academic historians. Jones was undeterred. She was hell-bent on resetting America's founding at 1619, when the first slave ship arrived in Virginia, thereby recasting the American tradition as something rotten to be discarded. 1776 has deep symbolic resonance. The spirit of 76, freedom, hope. If leftists can recast 1776 as a symbol of evil and slavery, if leftists can establish 1619 as the true dark origin of the United States, they will succeed at changing the public's unconscious conception of the country, and they will deal a death blow to any lingering patriotic sentiments. Facts and history be damned. For these modern progressives, history does not have an objective meaning at all. This is why it can be reset and rewritten at will. According to the Libs, symbols do not have any real relation to the concepts that they symbolize, and so they can reassign them however they like. They're like Humpty Dumpty in Alice in Wonderland. When Humpty Dumpty says, "When I use a word, it means just what I choose it to mean, neither more nor less." Alice responds, she says, "The question is whether you can make words mean so many different things." Humpty Dumpty has an answer. He says, "The question is, which is to be master? That's all." The Humpty Dumpty liberals are correct when they observe the nation-shaping power of words, of signs and symbols more broadly. The raising of even one pride flag on a government building is more politically powerful than every tax cut proposal ever passed or even written. The perversion of our symbols does not merely upend public policy. It cuts us off from our whole culture, the whole history of our civilization. If you have not been taught and brought up in the symbols of Christianity, not even that you were raised Christian and really believed, but if you don't even know them, the cross, wood, fish, on and on, you will be completely lost in an art museum. You won't be able to understand the vast majority of the great works of Western art, maybe none of them. You will be cut off from your own culture, a blank slate on which radical activists can write something new, precisely as they wish. The radicals tell us the old world was awful and they're going to create something much better. They say, "Some people see the world and say, why? I dream of things that never were and say, why not?" But the liberals are wrong, ultimately, in their belief that words and signs and symbols can mean whatever they want them to mean. A man remains a man, even if he chops himself up and calls himself Sheila. He's still a man. As he mutilates his appearance away from who he is and what he's meant to be, his nature doesn't change. He just becomes an uglier version of himself. This is true throughout all of society. As we knock down beautiful old buildings and erect new modern monstrosities according to the alternately utilitarian and decadent fashions of our age, beauty doesn't change. The Gothic cathedral and the old federal-style home are still more beautiful than the 1970s rec center church and the plastic modern cubes that architects now want us all to live in. Beauty remains what it is. Our society, by attempting to redefine beauty, just gets uglier. As we reach the end of this semester's campus tour, I have a great deal of hope. Not only because so many bright young people are eager and energized to right the ship of state, but because conservatives more broadly in recent years have gotten much better about speaking in terms of truth and falsehood. There's much less mealy-mouthed, middle-way language today. A lot more talk about truth and falsehood. Conservatives have even got better about speaking in terms of good and evil. We really didn't like doing that for a long time. We much preferred to feign ignorance of good and evil in the name of a false liberty and a supposed political neutrality that did not and cannot ever exist. And so that's a big improvement too. Now, looking ahead to next semester and beyond, we need to reacquaint ourselves with the third transcendental, beauty. We need to stop pretending that symbols, words, art, architecture don't matter. We argue about truth through the conscious action of our intellect. We discern goodness with the help of our moral conscience. But we encounter beauty and ugliness, I'm sorry to say, mostly unawares. We are inundated at all times with signs and symbols, which often bypass the intellect. It's like the air that we breathe. It's like the water that a fish swims in. We must take back the symbols that the left has perverted. We must take them back and restore them to accord with reason and reality. No more fake pronouns. No more woke jargon. No more rainbow flags on our government buildings or anywhere else, as far as I'm concerned. No more gender unicorns in our schools. No more exaltation of ugliness in public life. We still know quite a lot about what is good and true and beautiful. And we still have a self-government, at least some semblance of one. And we have a responsibility to wield our intellect and our will to turn our nation off its present path of decay and back not only toward its former glory, but toward a future that is even brighter, because the vision that we pursue is even better, even truer, and even more beautiful than before. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
The Q&A portion of the evening will now begin. So if you can line up behind my colleague here and then just state your name and a short question.
We do have a rule at the Daily Wire. I'm obligated, probably contractually, to mention this. If you disagree with me, and I know it's Old Miss, so it's not going to happen, but if you disagree with me, you do get to cut to the front of the line. But I'm looking at a dapper gentleman wearing a bow tie. There is a 0% chance that this man disagrees with me.
Hello, sir. My name is Bruce Thomas. I have a question about the truth and how we can take back the truth. And so St. Athanasius once said, if the world is against the truth, then I'm against the world. So how can we be against the world in times like these?
We are obviously opposed to the world in as much as the world is under the thrall of the Prince of Darkness, and we wage war against the principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places. This is not to say, however, as some Christians have believed, that we have no role in public life, that because the world is so fallen, we just need to run for the hills and put our heads in the sand and hope for the best. The civil authority is there for our good. God puts it there for our own good. Justice is a good thing to have. Order is a good thing to have. We have faculties of reason and a moral conscience. We can discern with reasonable clarity what is good and what is true and even what is beautiful. And in this country, we are at least supposed to have the right to self-government. And so far from conservatives running for the hills or turning away from politics as somehow a hopelessly corrupted and corrupting aspect of reality that we give to the devil and we run away, we should accept our role and our responsibility to improve our lot and to pursue justice. The basic charge of statesmen is to do good and to avoid evil. And there's nothing Christian or moral about letting the cruel rape the land. There's nothing good about that at all. We have the right to fix things. We have a responsibility to fix things. And as you imply in your question, the only way that we're going to do that is by orienting the country toward God. The people who founded our country understood this from its earliest days. The people who arrived in 1620 on the Mayflower were Christian religious zealots, okay? The people who came after, shortly thereafter, described this place as a shining city on a hill and a model of Christian charity. This is true all the way up through the founding fathers. I know there were lots of lib enlightenment thinkers that were having their ideas percolate at the time, but our founding fathers were crystal clear about the need for this to be a Christian nation. John Adams said it, John Jay said it, a whole lot of the founding fathers said it. And if we try foolishly to ground our country on anything else, on some secular idea or on some hyper-rationalized idea of an abstract good, we're gonna flop, it doesn't work. To the point of my speech, we are creatures that communicate through intelligible symbols. We need something to look at. And what are we going to look at to see the face of our God? We're going to look at the cross, okay? And we're going to look at the God who has animated our whole civilization and inspired our whole civilization from the beginning. Or we just won't have a civilization anymore.
Thank you, sir.
Great question. Thank you.
Hi. Hi, my name is Emily. Sorry. And I'm a graduating senior, and I hate to bring up transgender issues yet again, but I think it's important, not just for the advice that I'm seeking, but also to bring to light that Ole Miss isn't as perfect and conservative as we'd like it to be. So I wanted to share a quick little story about something that happened a week ago. I'm an education major, and in that we do these teach live avatar-like animation practices of teaching. And then in your senior year, you do a parent-teacher conference. And through reading my notes in preparation, we were told that the student that we're meeting with the parents for is transgender, and that we are to refer to them using they/them pronouns. And also, if the name was Timothy, and they wanted to be called Tim with a Y, which didn't really change the sound of Tim, but I was going to run with it.
The feminists did that, too, with women. You remember that W-I-M-M-Y-N or that? I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think it works, but we'll let them have it. Yeah. Anyways, so in that, I had to meet, and I chose to just not use any pronouns at all. I used him throughout my entire speech referring to the student, and I tried to use all the ways of not using a pronoun. However, my colleagues in the meeting chose to use the they/them pronouns, and we were warned that the parent might have an issue with that. So the parent, again, just an animation, comes at my colleagues and says, this is crap, we're not going to use those they/them pronouns. And I'm kind of sitting there like snapping my fingers under the table because I can't really say anything about it. But I proceeded to go through without using pronouns. They kept trying to push against the parent. And that was my first experience with that. And it does make me nervous knowing that I'm graduating in a week and have already accepted a position in a high school classroom, just how to navigate that as I do try to care for the student, but also acknowledge where they're wrong and to address the fact that the parent is still the parent, especially because I will be teaching minors who truly don't have a say in that yet.
Right.
So any advice you can give would be wonderful.
Can I ask, did you accept a job teaching in Mississippi?
I did.
Okay, so Mississippi is still kind of a normal place, right? It's not right. Like you accepted in L.A. County. I mean, you're in a good spot to be in. Right? But that matters, and increasingly location is going to matter. I am from New York. You might be able to tell from my overall demeanor, swarthiness, mode of speech. I lived in California for a long time, and then we fled. We fled because they locked us all down, and they wanted to take all of our money, and the place is going to sink into the bottom of the ocean. So we left for Tennessee, which is freer and more normal, and now I get to raise my kids there, and it's fabulous, you know? It's a wonderful place. We could have gone to Texas. All my exes live in Texas, so I hang my hat in Tennessee. And that's going to happen as people split. You know, the politics are becoming too radicalized, and the only way out is through. Either we're going to become a totally leftist country, or the conservatives are going to reassert themselves and say, no, I'm not going to call a little girl him, and I'm not going to call a little boy her. And so at that point, you're going to see an increase in the tension. You're going to see an increase in the wrath on the left. But that's that. The only other option would be surrender. So I would recommend being wise as a serpent and innocent as a dove. I would recommend ballasting yourself in a strong community, because that's the only way to make any political change is in public through a community. You're not going to do it as the lone smart teacher out in Los Angeles. And then I would, in some cases, perhaps refrain from using pronouns if it's a temporary kind of matter. And in some cases, perhaps be more assertive. But in no cases can you lie. And I think that if you believe that your job is going to require you to lie, you got to get a new job.
Absolutely. Thank
Best
you so
of
much.
Luck.
Thank
Absolutely.
You.
Hey, my name's Mason Ayers. My question is about boycotting the military. Well, not boycotting the military, but the conservative boycott of Bud Light went fairly well, and in my opinion, that was a pretty easy thing to do because it's easy to, you know, just pick up a Miller Lite instead of a Bud Light. But with the military, they've been going woke as well. So how do we go about letting the military know that we don't agree with their ways without completely abandoning the military, because it is an important part of our nation?
Yeah, you can't boycott the military. For starters, because this president is about to get us into World War III, and so we want to have a good, strong military. But two, because the military doesn't operate in a market. So you can boycott a beer company, and depending on how much of a lock the handful of brands have over the market, you can be effective. This has been surprisingly effective against Bud Light. There's no market there in the military, so the only way is through political action. That's the only way to bring these guys to heel, these top brass who are whining about white rage while Vladimir Putin mocks us and Chairman Xi mocks us. And we now have drag queens, you know, recruiting for the U.S. Navy. You know, in the old days, there were always lines about the U.S. Navy that people would make jokes about. It used to be a joke, though, you know, and then the sailors would say, how dare you? But now it's the recruiting tool. That's totally backwards. The idea that the greatest threat that Chairman Milley thinks that the U.S. Army faces is white rage is a joke. I mean, that guy should have been out of a job the next day after he said that. And so the only way through that, given that the military is the military, it's not just one force among many, is we need to win elections, and then we need to fire a lot of people. You know, the federal bureaucracy, depending on how you count it, is about 2 million people. It's a lot of people. And a regular president can fire about 4,000 to 5,000 people. That's it. It's pretty much impossible to fire anyone else. You would need to be able, I think, to increase that number of who you can fire to about 50,000, which is still a drop in the bucket compared to 2 million. But you really just need to get the guys who are setting the policy in this backwards way. If you could fire about 50,000 of the people in the federal bureaucracy, that would go a long way toward changing things. But the only way that you're going to do that is by gaining political power and wielding that political power. Until quite recently, Republicans haven't wanted to do it. Have they learned their lesson? I hope so, especially when it comes to the military. You know, bombs flying from Moscow. I hope that shows them that the real threat comes from elsewhere in the world and not from frat guys making jokes online or whatever they seem to think that it is now.
Thank you. Yep.
Hi, Big Mike. Thanks for coming here.
Thank you for using my proper nickname and preferred pronouns, Big and Mike. Yeah.
My name is William. I'm a law student here, and I was reading this excellent book recently.
You're clearly a discerning scholar and a man of great taste. Was that that's speechless, controlling words, controlling
it
words?
It is indeed.
It's available on Amazon or any bookstore you wanted to order.
Anywhere.
That's interesting.
But your event with the squirt gun at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, stuck out to me, and especially the chancellor's apology. In his apology to your protesters, he explained that allowing you to speak rested on the First Amendment's application to the public university. And I think a lot of public university administrations are allowed to more openly apologize for hosting conservative speakers while hiding behind the First Amendment. And aside from the large brand name private universities, I haven't noticed the same treatment from as many private liberal arts colleges. So do you think the First Amendment allows public university administrations to oppose more vocally conservative speakers than private university administrations who may have to appear more moderate to appeal somewhat to conservative parents and students?
It certainly does, and so that's one of the side effects is I've been to schools, I won't even name them, but I've been to schools recently where the administration hated my guts and truly did everything they could to keep me off campus, and I've been to schools where the administration was a little bit chilly in their public statements, but actually was quite supportive of my coming, and so being able to hide behind the First Amendment actually helped them, and I've been canceled from private schools. I've been canceled from Catholic private schools because I say men and women are different. Because it's not even just like a basic Catholic truth. That's just a thing that everyone has known for all of human history. And so for describing the Catholic view of anthropology, a Catholic speaker is not allowed at a Catholic college, shows you the state of Catholic education in a lot of America. So I think we still benefit from the public schools, even if the chancellors, in this case at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, come out and after I'm attacked at the school, he apologizes to the students that I was invited in the first place. That seems kind of crazy. But then, because it's a public school, that guy got dragged before the Missouri State Senate. He ultimately didn't lose his job, but they at least shook him around a little bit and taught him a lesson, I hope. So it's a difficult one to get around. And to your point, conservatives need to get a little bit better about not just defending our speech on the basis that everyone has a right to speak. We need to positively defend our speech. We need to say, no, it's good to say true things. And actually, it's bad to say false things. You're beginning to see some Republican politicians take up the plea that I made in my book, which is we need to get a little bit better about censoring the libs, okay? I'm not saying we need to go around door to door and burn all their books or anything, though who knows, what stupid books are they reading? It's probably not very valuable, but we don't want to do that. But we do want to get rid of Gender Queer by Maya Kababi in the elementary schools, right? We do want to get rid of the gay porn that they're putting into our schools. And furthermore, we want to put our books back into school because they pretend that they're all for free speech and they don't want to ban books. What is the one book? What is the one book in America that you cannot be taught in a public school? Is it Mein Kampf? Is it gay porn? No, do you know what it is? It's the Bible. Not only the best book ever written, but the most important book for understanding our whole civilization. So they're full of it. We need to get a little bit better about articulating our views and setting standards that will exclude some of their crazy ideas from the public square.
Thank you. Good.
Hi, Michael. My name is Becca Kaminsky, and my question is about all this crazy AI stuff that's going on right now. So recently, you've talked a lot about how AI is becoming a huge problem, especially when it comes to pornography. So my question is, as a parent, how are you planning to protect your kids from this industry, this pandemic that is happening to our society and the nuclear family? And what are some ways, as a woman, that I could play in dismantling this prevalent issue?
No smartphones. That's the first place. My kids are still a little young, though these days kids are born. They come out of the womb on TikTok, so no smartphones, period. I think if you give a kid a smartphone, it's just a portal to hell. I mean, you can't blame the kid when the kid looks up naughty things. It's just going to happen. I think the average age that people are exposed to pornography today is 12. That's the average age or median age. It can be much younger. It can be as young as 8 or 9 years old. So you've got to limit that. You've got to pay attention to what kind of schools they're going to. And, you know, in some reasonable parts of the country, public schools are fine. In other parts, they're not fine, and you need to find an alternative. And some of the alternatives to that could be through school choice. Some of the alternatives could be through homeschooling, and you just foot the bill yourself. I'm not saying it's easy or cheap, but there are ways to do it. And in fact, I think Senator Cruz made it easier to do that sort of thing by slipping in a greater funding provision into legislation around 529 accounts, so it doesn't only go to woke colleges, but it actually can be spent at other places. So you could look into that as well. And you've got to check, because even the private schools in a lot of these places, private schools in LA are crazier than the public schools. They're going to teach you weirder gender pornographic stuff than the public schools are, and you're going to pay $50,000 a year for the privilege of that. So, you know, you've got to be very aware of your community, and your community is more than just the people who come to your house on Sundays and the school that your kids goes to. You know, the community is going to involve the church. The community is going to involve your physical neighborhood, which even today still matters. These are people you're going to see. We should take a lesson from the libs. When the libs say it takes a village to raise a child, Hillary Clinton says that because she just wants to claw all your children away and do whatever she wants to them. But there's a lot of truth to that. You know, we're the social creature. We're a political animal. We are mimetic beings. In fact, we're educated by imitating what our mommies and daddies say and do, and even by the desires of the people that we spend a lot of time with. So there's a pithy little phrase, which is that you are the average of the five people you spend the most time with. That's certainly true. And so if your kid is spending time around a bunch of degenerates or people who just have the wrong idea about a lot of things, they're going to fall into that kind of stuff. And if the people that they're spending the most time with are phantoms flickering on a screen on their phone, that will be all the worse. That's one practical step. And then, I don't know, build a moat, build a big wall, I don't know, get a lot of guns or something. That would be the second step. Great question.
Hi, my name's Luke. I love film personally, and I love all the stuff you guys are producing over there. I just want to know, do you still have the thong you wore during the gay sex scene in House of Shades?
I don't think they let me keep that one. What our friend here is referring to, back in my wayward youth, I was never a gay guy, but I was worse. I was an actor. I was an actor, and the show he's referring to, I was in a Yale undergraduate thesis film, and I thought it was a gay character, but I recently reread it. I reread a review of this movie on some LGBT site, and they reminded me, it's a bisexual character. And they were very upset with me, because on the one hand, they wanted to insinuate that I'm a little light in the loafers. But then on the other hand, they got very angry with me because they said that homophobe, Michael Knowles, he wouldn't even kiss a man on camera. And I said, I don't remember. I did this thesis film when I was an undergraduate. I don't remember anything about it. But apparently, they were very offended, because just as it looks like we're going to kiss, the camera pans away. They begged. They said, Michael, please, anybody who's associated with this film, please write to us at lgbtreport.org, or I don't know, whatever it was. And they said, please tell us what it was like to work on this important film. So I have two takeaways from it. One, I'm very honored that some of my acting work from when I was 20 or something is finally making it to a large stage. I look forward to my invite to the Oscars this year. But second of all, I get a real kick out of this too, because the Libs, who, they tell us that all this LGBT stuff, it's totally fine, it's great, wave the rainbow flag. But then they insinuate that it's a bad thing to play these characters. And what's amazing, I've probably played 200 roles, and I didn't even have a long acting career, but I have played a lot of roles. I've played murderers. I've played serial killers. I played Satan himself. But the one that they find most objectionable is when I play a gay guy. It's absolutely, terribly homophobic. But thank you for watching my work. There are other great movies you can watch on Amazon, too.
Hey, my name is Jeffrey Cage, and I was just wondering, well, I have a bit of a hypothetical question for you, if that's all right. So I'll try to be quick. So you have Joe Biden and Donald J. Trump. Let's say a 5-gallon bucket of lube. Who would you say is winning the twerk off?
Hold on, you'll have to repeat the last part. It was somewhat muddled in your description of it.
There's a 5-gallon bucket of lube provided for both of them to share.
Mm-hmm.
Who would you say is going to win the twerk off?
Oh, that's obvious. It would be Trump. Trump is a young, vibrant, energetic man. He could, I don't know if you saw him dance on Saturday Night Live. He is excellent. Joe Biden can't walk around anywhere. A flight of stairs could do him in any day, God forbid. An ice cream cone that's too large could do him in. And so Donald Trump would obviously win that. And the other reason is that Donald Trump is better at every single thing than Joe Biden is. Great question.
Hi, Michael. My name is Landry Sutton, and I'm glad he broke the ice for me. I was wondering, I thought of this during your speech, when deciding which candidate to support in 2024, how should Republicans weigh the obvious and enormous symbolic value of renominating President Trump against the less symbolic, though possibly more substantive value of other candidates?
I do not make endorsements in primaries as a general rule. Every Republican seems to have an answer to this right now. I'm for this large orange candidate, or I'm for this governor of Florida, or he is usually those two, but there's some other people occasionally pop up. My take on it is, you don't need to confront the question yet, because it's very, very early, and everyone wants to immunitize the eschaton. You know, everybody is trying to just race forward, but we've got a lot of time. It's early 2023, and there are candidates every cycle who seem like they are the leading breakthrough candidate, who sometimes they're the first ones out, or they're out within the first, you know, 6 months or something. So that can happen. And it can be excellent candidates, by the way. It can be truly some of the best people who are in the race. They can be some of the first people out. And so I'm looking at the race right now, because this is a 501c3, I'll try to speak in not direct candidate terms. But the leading candidate in the race right now, the one who everyone has assumed will win the nomination, and who was the best president of my lifetime, I'm just not saying any names, but that candidate maintains a dominant position, and his numbers are going up. And there's another candidate who's a serious contender in the race, who's been a superb governor and very well could make a great presidential candidate, but his numbers have not really increased, and according to some polls, they're going down. And so it might not be a problem that we have to confront. And the other reason it might not be a problem that we have to confront is because a lot of people are not going to be making these decisions in a hyper-conscious, white paper policy focused way. You're gonna see two guys on stage, they're gonna duke it out, you're gonna get a gut feeling. Events are gonna present themselves. If this were a month ago, you might say foreign policy doesn't matter at all. If two drones try to kill Vladimir Putin at the Kremlin and we end up in World War III, then foreign policy is gonna matter a lot. And some candidates are gonna do better in one world and some candidates are going to do better in the other. But broadly speaking, I value competence greatly. And very importantly, as you might be able to tell from my speech, I think symbols matter a great deal.
Thank you.
Was that cryptic enough?
Hi, Mr. Knowles. Thank you so much for being here. I've been ranting about this to my boyfriend for like the past week. So.
That's so sweet of you.
So my question is that, well, to start off, I'm a theater major. I'm actually a designer. I'm not an actor. So.
Lucky you. Right. And lucky your boyfriend, too. You know, I mean, listen, I say it as an actor. I say it with love. Some of my best friends are actors. But you're going to live a more stable, normal,
exactly.
well-adjusted life if you're not an
yes,
actress.
Yes, sir. Yeah. But I'm sure, as you know, like the theater world, the film world is very, very woke right now. There's a lot of stuff going on that do not represent our values, especially Christian values. There's just a lot. So my question is, how do I represent my values in my work when literally every project I work on is going against my values?
This is a question near and dear to my heart. May have experienced it once or twice myself. And I recall getting to a place where all of the projects that I had worked in as an actor, which even though I did it very briefly, you know, there's that old joke, you know, you build a fence, no one calls you a carpenter. You fix the electric, no one calls you an electrician. But you do one extremely disreputable thing, and that's all people ever call you. And it's kind of like that with acting. But I recall being in New York and LA, and I saw all the projects have these terrible messages. It's just, not all, but a lot of them do. And so what's the point? You know, the point of working in the theater and working in film is to tell stories. And you want the stories to convey not pretense exactly, but you want them to be able to tell the truth through imaginary circumstances. And so that means you need a decent writer, and it means you need competent people, and it means you need a vision, an artistic vision. And I see that totally lacking in New York right now in theater. I see that pretty much totally lacking in LA. There's some exception. The place where it's happening, I don't just say it to toot our own horn, but it's at places like the Daily Wire, and it's at places who are going out and making entertainment content and acquiring entertainment content that is being blacklisted. And so I would say if you want to have a career in show business, especially as politics increasingly becomes important, and if you don't want to go to the Bernie Sanders fundraiser, and if you don't want to go to all these lib crazy things, that's going to seriously hamper your career. Then you're going to have to find people that you want to work with. I mean, even this is true throughout the industry. You think about like a Judd Apatow movie. All the same actors are in all the same Judd Apatow movies. And this is because people like working with their friends and they like working with people that they regularly work with. And so you need to find people who are capable of doing that, and you need to find the artistic vision that speaks to you. And you also need to find a community, and that's where your career is going to thrive. It's true in show business. It's true really in every line of work.
Thank you for coming here tonight. I appreciate that. We'll make it quick. I guess we're in a hurry. So with the left pushing for another Bolshevik revolution in Russia and the open hostility towards white Christians in America, why should white Christians die for this new America?
Well, is it a new America?
Yeah, they're trying to remake it. We don't have a border.
No, you're totally right that the libs are trying to remake America.
Yeah.
But I guess my question is it a new America? I mean, the numbers are pretty sad. There was a report that just came out from the Department of Education, which is that eighth grade understanding of civics and history has dropped to its lowest level since the 1990s. All the gains that had been acquired have been totally wiped out, and history and civics were especially they were the two most dismal subjects, worse than math, worse than all the rest. Why is that? Seems to me that that's by design, because there are leftist radicals who are trying to rewrite our history, who are trying to remake our government and keep people ignorant of the basic facts of our government. So that's happening. We have an effectively open border. The U.S. officials are preparing for 10,000 plus daily illegal crossers across just the southern border. So you're talking about over 3.5 million people per year if that rate continues. That's And by the way, that's on top of the million legal immigrants who come in every year. So that's a huge amount of people. I mean, you're talking about greater than 1% of the U.S. population, the current U.S. population, coming into the country every single year. The movement of people into the United States over the last 60 years is the largest movement of people in recorded history. So yeah, that's really dismal, man. And then if you look on the domestic front, you see the libs totally gut our economy, rewrite much of our constitution, take away a lot of our rights, and the conservatives have failed even to conserve the women's bathroom. Until now, I think actually they're pushing back pretty well right now. But all of that to say, is this a new America? Or is this just your country, your beloved country, in a state of disrepair and decay? I think it's the latter. And I think that patriotism is not just something to be given when we approve of the things that are going on. I think patriotism is an extension of filial piety, and I think it's something that you owe to your country just as you owe love and respect to your parents. And I think that that your country is a part of your identity. No man is an island entire of himself. You're not an isolated individual floating out there in the ether. You're a member of this political community, and you're a citizen, and that comes with responsibility, which is you have a responsibility to serve your country, but it comes with rights as well. And these are rights that have been chipped away at and that have voluntarily not been exercised by conservatives for the last 50 years. But you have the rights to say no. I love the word no. I think no is a word we need to embrace in politics. I think limits are what makes sonnets beautiful. And so we need to say no. And the next time that we have political power in the country, we need to stop merely trying to take a few steps back or just hold the left at bay. We need to reclaim ground that they have already taken. So we need to say, no, we're not going to try to reduce illegal immigration from 3 million to 2.5 million. We're going to get rid of illegal immigration, but furthermore, we're going to drastically reduce legal immigration too, which is what the majority of Americans want to do according to public opinion surveys. On the issue of transgenderism, this is what got the libs in such a fit about my CPAC speech. It's why they had to libel me. It's why the White House had to libel me. The CPAC speech said, we're not going to argue about whether we should trans the 7-year-olds or the 8-year-olds. That's a ridiculous, we've already lost if that's the debate. We need to eradicate transgenderism from public life entirely, the whole preposterous ideology at every single level, for the good of society and especially for the good of the poor people who've fallen prey to that confusion. We've got to take back the ground that we have ceded to the left. And the reason we haven't done that is a failure of conservative imagination. The libs, for all their faults, they never suffer from a failure of imagination. They're always looking 25 steps ahead, and they get so much pushback. AOC proposes the Green New Deal. Mitch McConnell laughs her out of the room. Who's having the last laugh? Much of the Green New Deal was already passed into law in the so-called Inflation Reduction Act, which the Democrats immediately acknowledged was really a climate change bill, not an inflation bill. It made inflation worse. And what's AOC doing now? She just reintroduced that legislation. They normalize these radical ideas. They don't worry about losing the median moderate voter. Well, we can't get too serious about men and women and sex and immigration and I don't know anything else that matters at all. We need to recapture that imagination. We need to reassert our rights. We need to win political power. We need to wield the political power. And we got to say no to the people who want to wreck our country. I don't think that hope is gone. I think hope is not just a nice feeling, but a theological virtue and a fact. And I think that patriotism is something that we owe, and it's a right that we can assert.
Hi, Mr. Knowles. So I need some advice on a touchy subject with my family. I have a cousin back in the Chicagoland area. She's 19 now and has been going down the liberal rabbit hole for like 4 years now. And first off, saying like she's pansexual or whatever that means. Yeah. And now
it means give me attention is what it means, but yeah, you know, many such cases
because she can't get anywhere else, but now she's saying her preferred pronouns are he and him, and I've brought it up to my parents. My dad won't say anything to his brother, and I don't know how to bring it up to my family without totally losing contact with my uncle or tearing the family apart. I just want to know if there's anything I can do to prevent her from mutilating herself and destroying her life.
I would recommend you be very clear about this. And we are called to speak the truth in love, and I think this would be a clear place where you could apply that teaching. And I think that it's better not only for her, but better for you, ultimately, and your relationship with your family. And it's better in that if she does mutilate herself and comes to regret it, you'll feel terrible that you didn't help her. It's because you'll have to deal with this fact of how she's presenting herself. Are you going to lie to appease her? Are you going to tell the truth? Further down the line, that's going to be harder. But I also think it's important to be clear, because when people are clear and they have a consistent point of view, that can engender respect and even affection. You see this if you're going to ask a girl out on a date. Sometimes people write into my show, they ask me, usually not for pansexual things, but you know, regular dating. They'll say, I'm nervous, how do I ask a girl out on a date? And I say, in my experience, and I don't have much recent experience, but my experience, there's two ways to get a girl to like you. You can either be the strong, silent type, Gary Cooper, doesn't say very much, keep to yourself, that can be very attractive. Or I'm of the Italian persuasion, we're a little more vocal and emotional about things. You can be very forthright and you can say, listen, baby, I love you. I think you're beautiful. We got to go get a drink. Let's go. You can't deny me. I'm in love. You can write love poetry, right? And that can be charming too. The thing that's not going to work is that middle ground when you try to say, well, you know, hey, Sheila, I kind of think you're cute or something, but I don't know. Do you maybe want to go get a meal sometime? Or I don't know, whatever you want to do. That's not attractive at all. And I think this is true in so many areas of public life. If you come out and you say, hey, they, them, hey, you know, Cyborg 7, I totally affirm whatever delusion you've got, and you can chop yourself up, and I'm totally on board, your cousin will like you. If you come out, conversely, and say, look, hey, uncle, hey, cuz, I love you guys, of course, I would just advise you to maybe rethink this, and here's why I think that, because it seems to me that men and women are different, and the transgender surgery isn't real. It doesn't do anything, and women have all sorts of terrible side effects from the testosterone. It increases rage, it increases libido. I interviewed one woman who detransitioned. She said she became so violent when she took the testosterone that she turned the violence on herself. She was very lucky because she said, I'm glad I didn't turn it on anyone else. You can point to skyrocketing rates of regret. You can point to the largest data set on the transgender procedures, both hormonal and surgical, which show that transgender procedures do not have the promised mental health benefits. That, in fact, when you look at anxiety, depression, suicidality, not only do the numbers not improve, but on the case of anxiety, the numbers actually get worse after the procedure. So you could point to that. You could point to the relative novelty of this idea and say, hey, you know, cuz, uncle, does it seem kind of weird to you that this understanding of what boys and girls are has just been completely radically altered in the last, 5 minutes from what it always was for all of human history? Maybe introduce some questions there and say, look, I just don't think it's true, and I think you're harming yourself, and because I care about you, I'm going to tell you the truth. They might not like it. They might even sort of yell at you, but you're much more likely to have their respect and ultimately their affection if they think that you are speaking to them truthfully because you love them, because you will the good of that other person, not as some instrumental matter to you, but for her own sake.
Thank you.
And this will be our last question.
No, I want to stay at Ole Miss all night. I never want to go back to any other school.
Mr. Knowles, we wish you could stay at Ole Miss all night. Thank you very much for coming out. So, sir, I wanted to ask you speak oftenly about the staunch differences, but beautiful differences, between men and women. And I would love to hear your opinion and your take on why traditional masculine values are under such attack by the left, and do you believe that is to contribute to the dissolution of the nuclear family?
Friend of mine once described liberalism in a pithy way. It's the most precise way I've ever heard it summarized. He said that all of liberalism comes down to, screw you, Dad! And I think he's right. I've read many long essays and treatises on it. I think it does come down to that. I think that the libs hate the idea of a masculine man because a masculine man is living in accord with virtue and He's the stronger sex, the head of his family, traditionally. And so because liberalism is a rebellion against all manner of constraints, then obviously a man, a strong man, a just, moral strong man is going to be part of that. Ultimately, it's a rebellion against God. It's not a new ideology. It's the second oldest one. It's the oldest ideology, which was Whitaker Chambers, the former communist, said, goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden, and it comes from the mouth of the serpent who says, ye shall be as gods. So you've got two ideas. Do we restrain some of our desires and submit ourselves to reality, to the moral order, to God's providence, to our duties, to all of that? Or do we pursue a politics that is entirely about the will and about the self and try to shake off all constraints beginning with the old regime, constraints like tradition, constraints like the moral order, then constraints like the family, yes, as you mentioned, and then ultimately biological constraints, even the liberation from the individual himself, which is of course impossible. The liberation from the individual himself can amount to nothing more than his own destruction. It will amount to a suicide, which is enacted in the transgender transition when one ritually kills the old self and buries his history and calls him a dead name and then creates a new name and a whole new biography. And but the problem is you're still left with yourself. There's a good bit of wisdom from Alcoholics Anonymous on this, which is that wherever you go, there you are. And so as long as you exist, you're going to find that you'll be stymied by that inability to free yourself. You're always promised a utopia right on the other side of this or that constraint. But the constraints, when they're just and appropriate, are what give harmony to the world and what make things beautiful. Slam poetry is the death of art, and Elizabethan sonnets are lovely. So what we need to recognize is that this debate that the liberals would have us take between constraint, authority, authoritarianism, and freedom, that's not real at all. We're always going to be bound by constraints. This is a finite world. We're creatures living in time and space. We have bodies. We have limits. The question is going to be, which limits are we going to accept? The limits of a just leader of our family and the just leader of our community, the just leader of our nation, ultimately our just and perfect God, or the limits of the other guy, the limits of the guy who says, transcend all of that, and ye shall be as gods. You are submitting yourself and suppressing your desires, perhaps, or at least suppressing your exercise and your will. In both cases. In one, though, the wages of it will be death, and in the other, the yoke is easy and the burden is light. Thank you very much. Wonderful to be with everybody. Thank you.